Hello. In this video, we are going to do the part 1B of the exercise on grounding, of the grounding part of the course Answers at Solving in Practice. So here we have these facts that define some sets and the elements. And we have this encoding, which solves the problem, the hidden set problem. So these first two rules allows us to select some set of elements occurring in the set. And then this rule tells us that we cannot choose two elements from a set. And these two rules tell us that we must choose for each set at least one element. So then this means putting all together that we have to select some set of elements such that for each set there is one element selected and no more. Good, so let's do this exercise about grounding. And here I have written the program and the set of facts, just replacing the edge predicate by E and select by S and so on. So let's start with it. First, what we will do here is just write the dependency graph of the program. Okay, and for this, let's call this rule R1, this R2, this R3, and here we have R4 and R5. And then we have that R1 defines the atom SX that appears in R2, in R3, and in R4. So we have these edges from R1 to R2 and to R3 and R4. And we will, given that the S here appears negatively and in the other two cases positively, we will write here a minus and here a plus. And then the second rule defines an S that does not appear anywhere else. And the fourth one defines heat of S that appears negated in rule 5. Then we also have this edge. Good, so then the dependency graph is just this graph without the labels. So let's paint it here, R1 to R2 and to R3, R4 and then R5. And formally, we can represent it like this. We have the set of rules P and then we have the link R1 to R2, R2 to R1. R1 to R3, and then R1 to R4, and R4 to R5. These are the edges, and these are the vertexes of the rules are the vertexes of the graph. And before we continue, we can paint the strongly connected components. So here we have S1 and S2, because from each of the rules we can go to the others and then back to themselves. And then R3, R4, and R5 are also components of it. So then one topological ordering of this graph would be this R1, R2 first, and then we do R3, and then we do R4, and then we do R5, right? And what we see here is that, of course, R1 and R2 have to go before the others, and R4 has to go before R5, but R3 can go before R4 or R5, or R3 can go between R4 or R5, and R3 could go afterwards. So we could have here the same R1, R2, and then R4, R5, R3, or the same here, but R4 and then R3 in the middle. Okay. So we would have these three options here. Okay, and now if we write the positive dependency graph, then here we are just left with these two edges. So then we have here R1 to R3 and to R4, and then this GP plus equals P, comma, and the edges R1, R3, and R1, R4. And then when we want to make this LP, all we have to care is about this, about like finding the topological ordering of these, the set of these two rules. And here we could choose either, given that there are no edges between R1 and R2, actually we could write here R1 and R5 because they belong to the graph, but there are no edges between the between them and the others. So given that they are not connected here, we could choose either ordering them in any way. So then we will select first R1, then R2, then R3, then R4, and R5. But of course, we could have selected first R2 and then R1. And also we could have selected here to put the R3 after R4 or the R3 after R5. Okay, but for the exercise, it's enough just to, and actually for the grounder, it's enough just to keep one of these orderings, and we stay with this one. And now what we have to do is to determine the sets R for each rule. So for this, we only have to care about the negative literals that appear in the program and check whether those the atoms of those literals occur in later rules. So here we have this not ns of x, and ns of x occur in the head. If they occur in the head of rules that are grounded afterwards. So this is the case here. Then we have to say that R of R1 is this ns of x. And this will tell us afterwards, please, when you are grounding this rule, do not simplify this rule, this literal, because in later rules, we may get some ground instances of these atoms. Good, but then for R2, it has the literal not SX, but it's not defined by later rules by S3, S4, or S5 here, right? This is defined by R1 that comes before R2. And then what else we have here? So in R5, we have not heat of S, but this is defined by the previous rule R4, right? We have them here. So then this means that R of R2 is equal to R over R3, R4, and R5, and they all are empty. Okay, good. So then this finishes the two first parts of the exercise where we had to define these sets and this ordering, and now we can move on to grounding the logic program P with the facts I. For doing this, I've cleaned all this information about the graphs, and I just put here our ordering and this information about the atom R. So initially we have that F, the facts are equal to I, and also the positive atoms are just equal to I. And then we have to ground the first rule here in our ordering, R1. And for this, we can look for the ground instantiation where the positive literals are possible. And then we can care about the negative literals. So for this, then given that we have these three facts about E, and these are the only possible atoms about predicate E, we start generating these four ground instances, and then we see what happens there. So we will have for E1A, E2B, E2C, and E3B. And then here we must have not NSA, not NSB, not NSC, and not NSB. Okay, and then the head is just S of A, SB, S of C, and S of B. Good, and then given that we have used this for grounding and those are facts, we know we can delete them. Then what else do we know? So for this, for the negative literals, we should see whether some of these are facts, because in this case, the rule doesn't, it doesn't make sense that we have the rule, and indeed we have the fact ns of a, then this rule, this is never, this negative literal is never going to hold. So then we can get rid of this ground instance. I mean, in the first place, we could have just not written it if we had realized it, but I think it's easier just to make it this way. And now, for these three rules, now the temptation could be to say, look, NSB, NSC, and NSB, they are not even possible because they do not belong to here. Hence, we could simplify them and just get these three facts. But we have here that in rule R1, the negative literals of the this atom NSX, those are protected from simplification. So we have to keep them here because it may be the case that R2 gives us some instances from them. So we cannot simply say these are false because they can be made true by some rules that come afterwards. And then also we have to check whether these atoms here in the head are facts, because in that case we wouldn't need to ground the rule to get those ground rules, but we have no facts for them, right? Sorry, the facts are here, fact F equals I, and I will have it there. Then we get here these three ground rules. Now let's move on to the second one. So now first we can say that the facts are the same now, but now to the possible atoms, we also have SB and SC. But and now before we move on, if you look at here, these two rules are actually the same, right? So, but what is important here to realize is that we are following the algorithm of the grounder. And what the grounder will do is it first will ground this, and then it will ground this other. And it will spit both to the solver. And afterwards, the solver will realize that both are the same. And in the end, while solving, it will only be using one of them. Of course, it will do some transformations afterwards, but it will realize that both are the same at some point. But what matters here is that we realize that the grounding process will generate both. And in some cases, this may be, we may be a bit careful about this so that we write encodings where we do not, where the grounding does not generate a ground rule twice, because this may be bad for the efficiency, right? And we will see, I think, a bit more of it when we come to this constraint. Good, so now we know that SB and SC are possible. And of course, we don't have that SA is possible because we cannot get it from this rule, given that we know that A is not selected. But now let's do the same story for rule R2. So we use all the edges to generate the NS of X. So we come here with E1A, E2B, E2C, and E3B. And then in the body, we will have not S of A, not S of B, not S of C, not S of B. And then here S of A, S of B, S of C, and S of B. Again here. Okay, and then we know these become facts, so we can simplify them. And what else we have here? Here we have not selected. Yes, I was in that this rule was a bit strange that I have not. So we have the ends there. Right. So then what do we know for we go rule by rule? So here, we already have the fact ns of a, hence we don't want this ground instance anymore. And in fact, if we had a look at it, given that sa is not even possible, this would lead just to the fact. But what happens is that we already have it, so then we don't have to care about it. Now what happens with this is that sb, sc, and sb, they are, we don't have facts about them, and they are possible, so they stay there. And about this NS of B, C, and B, we do not have facts also, so then this will stay. And see how, as before, we have this rule twice, right? This is the same rule twice. Okay, then let's move it a bit so that we have a bit more space here. And now let's move to the rule, to the third rule. And here, now the facts are still the same, but for D we have SB, SC, and we also have NSC and NSB that are possible now because we have these rules here that give it to us. And this is, I think, let me just make it simply like this. Okay, now let's go to ground this rule. And here we should be a bit careful because suddenly we have many possibilities, right? Because we have, if we ground S, if we ground, look, given that we have these four facts about E, these atoms about E that may be possible, we could think about coming here with many options, right? So one has to think a moment about it. I think what makes more sense is to say, okay, we have three possible sets, and for the set, then for the set one, we could have E of 1A here, and E, the other option here would be E of 1A, but then A is not different to A, right? So then so then we couldn't have any ground instance for the set one. And similarly, the same thing happens for the set three, right? That if we have set of three, then the only possible atoms of E would force us to replace the X1 and the X2 by B. Hence, but then B is not different to B. Hence, we cannot have that ground instance. Then what happens is that we only have the option of using set two here, and using these two edges, these two elements, B and C. So then let's use this. And okay, also now I think something important. Now I have done this a bit quickly, but what you can of course do is try to do all the possible replacements and then apply simplification. So for example, you could replace the S by one and then E and then X1 by A and X2 by A. And only afterwards, when you come to this comparison, you will realize that that ground instance will not be generated because you will see that this comparison literal cannot be satisfied and then the ground instance is not generated. Okay, so then let's do for the case that we have analyzed where we have set of two and now we have the case where we have E to B and then we have SB and on the other part we have E to C and we have, select of C and we have that B is different to C. And here it's also, it's important to realize that here we can replace for, so once we have replaced X1 by B, then on X2 we only can choose the C because we are going to have this comparison that tells us that B and C must be different. But here we could have chosen in the first place E of 2C, right? So then we have this other option where we have set of 2, E of 2C, select of C, E of 2B. Again, as before, at this point, it doesn't make sense that we try choosing also here for E, for this atom, E of 2C, because then we would have that the comparison literally is not satisfied. Then we have select B and C different to B, right? And then we can simplify this, and this all these are facts. So we can get rid of this, and this comparison literal, they hold, hence we can get rid of them. So we eliminate all this, and this. And we end up with these two integrity constraints that are the same, right? Because here we have SB, SC, and here SC, SB. So this is another case like what we had before, where like here, that we have the same rule twice. And if you want to write an encoding that makes it that the grounder will ground faster, you can fix this by replacing this by the less than or by the greater than. Because if we had smaller than or less than, then here this ground instance wouldn't be generated, right? Because it wouldn't be the case that C would be smaller than B, because in Gringo these terms are lexicographically ordered, but here this would hold because B is smaller than C, and if we use less here, we would only get this ground distance. And you can see this just running Klingo with option --- text with this program. If you use the different that you write like this or the less than. Okay, nice. And then what happens? So here we get these two ground instances that the solver will realize that they are the same, but the grounder will produce both of them. And now we can continue and go for R4. And in this case, nothing has changed with respect to the true and the possible atoms. So we have the same story as before. And then to ground this rule, we can consider again all the E atoms that are possible. And then we do it here. So we have E1A, E2B, E2C, and E3B. Okay, and then we have if we have selected A, if we have selected B, if we have selected C, if we have selected B, then in this case, we hit 1, here we hit 2, we hit 2 also here, and here we hit 3. Okay, and all these are facts, so we can simplify them. And here what happens actually is that this rule, we wouldn't generate it because S of A is not even possible, right? It does not appear in this set. So this instance is not generated. So there's no, what this means is that there's no way to hit set 1. And this makes sense because we are not selecting A, and A is the only element of the set 1. And then for these rules, it's not the case that we have some facts for this, and these are possible, but they are not true at this point. Hence, these are the three ground rules that we obtain here. Okay? And now we can move to the last rule, and in this case, we can consider just all possible sets, 1, 2, 3. And let's move this down here. So, okay, now what happens is that the facts are the same as before, and the possible are I together with all those that we had before. But now we also have heat of 2 and heat of 3 that are possible, right? And now when we ground this, we can start using this atoms set. So then we will have with set 1, with set 2, and with set 3. And this would give us not hit 1 here, not hit 2 there, and not hit 3 at this point. But okay, and then of course this can be simplified. But what else can we do here? Okay, something that it's interesting. Well, it's not interesting, is that this is what we have to do, is that heat of 1 is not even possible, right? Because we said before that this rule we shouldn't even ground it because S of A is not even possible. Then we can simplify this and get rid of it. While for heat 2 and heat 3, we cannot do this because those are possible. And then basically what we get is these three ground instances. And if we look a bit more carefully, this one, what this is telling us is that, so this we could rewrite just like this, like this is the, okay, let's, like just the empty constraint. So what happens is that the grounder has derived the empty constraint. And what this means is that if the body holds and the empty body always holds, then we eliminate the stable model. Hence, what this does is it eliminates all stable models. So in a way, what they just simply by grounding, we have come to the conclusion that the program has no stable models because we have been able to derive these empty integrity constraints. And yes, but anyway, this is what the grounder will generate. These three ground rules here, these are the three there, these two here, these three here, and these three. And in the end, F will have the same value as before, and this value also. And okay, so now, yeah, this finished the exercise and it's all we had to do. But I think what here there are two important lessons. The first one is that the grounding procedure may generate repeated rules. And hence, it's a good idea to write encodings that do not generate those repeated rules. And for this, you have to know a bit how the grounding algorithm works. So for example, in this rule, if we replace it by this, here, this ground instance will not be generated and we will have only one of these. And another thing is that the grounder, just by applying, by the result of its procedure, applying these simplifications and so on, it may be able to prove that the program is unsatisfiable. Of course, in Klingo, Gringo will not tell you this is unsatisfiable, but this is passed, this ground program is passed to the solver clasp. And without doing any complicated step, it will see this and it will say, look, this is unsatisfiable. I don't even have to care about what is happening in the rest of the program, because if I have this, I know the program is unsatisfiable. Bang. So I stop. Okay, good. So then this finishes the exercise. I hope you have enjoyed. See you in another video. Ciao.